What's up, everybody? Welcome back to Golf Simulator Videos. We're back with an exciting video. Actually, Trackman has just released their PGA Tour average data, and it's been about 10 years since they did this last, so it's really interesting to look at what has changed over the years. Now, keep in mind, they have the PGA Tour data, then they also have the LPGA Tour data, so it could be just an amateur that's trying to see how they compare to the field, could be a pro seeing how the PGA Tour is performing out there. I did talk to Trackman too. I thought it was cool that they actually have the technology to verify that we're only including driver off the tee. Because I was thinking, you know, people are hitting three wood off the tee, might throw off some averages. But what was wild is that over this near 10-year period, there actually has not been a lot of change in data. So one of the numbers that stuck out that I thought we'd talk about today, and that actually affects so many golfers out there, is the backspin of driver. So I'm here with Darren Husse, Director of Instruction out at Warwick Hills Golf and Country Club. And we're not only gonna talk about the effects of backspin today, we're gonna show it in action using the TrackMan 4. There's all kinds of factors that can attribute to change in backspin with driver, Darren. I mean, everything from where you hit it on the face. A lot of people, you know, think of gear effect, whether it be toe or heel, but high or low, it's gonna change. You're talking about the golf swing, and I'm gonna let you dive into that stuff. I mean, you know, the actual spin loft, so that dynamic loft versus angle of attack. There's just so many factors, and I think the biggest one, so the difference that I saw in the PGA Tour average data is that it went down about 150 RPM, which doesn't sound like a lot, but when you're talking about, you know, I don't even know, hundreds of thousands of shots and that many players, that's a significant amount that's kind of went down. So it tells me that, you know, enough players out there were probably spinning the ball a little bit too much versus where they wanted it, you know, whether it be at that perfect launch angle or ball speed. We have new shafts. I mean, big changes in technology over the past 10 years or so. So between shaft and, you know, the head technology, things are changing. So, I mean, what do you see out there for the average golfer that they may be struggling with on backspin, and what is it affecting the most?
Well, so the average golfer spins the ball way too high. I would say the average good golfer typically spins the ball too low. But the average golfer that I work with on a daily basis always, for the most part, spins the ball too high. Yeah. And that's where we talk about that spin loft. They get angle of attack too steep, have a club face that's too far open. The most common swing miss amongst amateur golfers is a slice, a peeling slice, which is the highest spinning shot that you can have.
This is gonna kill their distance.
And it just kills distance. So, you know, I can't really get people to swing the club itself at much faster, but we can kind of optimize numbers to get people more distance. So it's amazing how much distance we can get by not getting them to swing faster, but by optimizing their spin numbers, whether it's through angle of attack, whether it's through club fitting, face loft, impact, controlling their impact, stuff like that. There's so many factors that goes into controlling somebody's spin, but I would say, on average, the average golfer spins the ball way too much.
That makes sense. So we're talking about, you know, PGA Tour average data. I would assume, and correct me if I'm wrong, if the average went down 150, which is probably significant considering all of that data, they're probably hitting the ball, I would have to say, a little harder and faster and a little up on it, you know, more than before. And so they can actually handle having a little bit lower spin because that's gonna optimize the distance, right?
Yeah, I think dynamically, there are some slight things that players do differently in their golf swings. And as you mentioned, we don't see any actual dynamic numbers, club numbers, that are like blowing us away. Everything is still very similar. So I think what we're seeing, I mean, you gotta think 10 years, that's a long time.
Think of a
10-year-old car right now, right? Yeah. How much technology has gone into the last 10 years. Yeah. And mainly what they've done is they've basically fought it. They've done it for amateur golfers. Their whole idea is to limit spin. So between different shafts, different bulge and roll effects of drivers.
We've seen all the material change on faces.
Material changes, faces, everything. Just the design of the driver, moving the MOI up higher on drivers to limit that. We talked about the gear effect where the club can actually move this way with a low strike, which makes the ball spin upwards versus ball hitting high, club goes this way, ball spins downwards. So they move that center of mass up higher, so a lower strike will continue to have lower spin because of that. So there's a lot of research and development that have gone into shafts, driver heads, everything in between. Yeah. And you can see the ball numbers change dramatically or somewhat dramatically over a long period of time and lots of swings. But the club numbers really don't show huge differences.
Yeah. What I'd like to do is I'd like you to hit a couple shots for us. And I know it's not easy to do. You're a great golfer. I'm hoping that we can pull this off. I'd like you to kind of hit your normal shot, which I know is similar to mine spin-wise, that lower, near 2,000. I mean, I'm below 2,000 too often. Give us one of those shots and let's look at the data.
Okay.
And then we're going to try to hit one with some higher spin. Maybe we'll hit it lower on the face to help out with that. And I'm sure you can control your path and face a little, you know, which will affect some of that, you know, change your swing up.
Okay.
And let's compare this data and we'll explain to the viewers, you know, really how this is going to really change their game if they work on it.
Exactly, yeah.
Coach, get fit, hit it better on the face, all those different types of things.
Yeah.
I'm not going to normalize the data. I'm just going to let the wind play in effect. It's in our face right now. You can see the flags out there. So, man, that was too good of a demonstration. So, yeah, 6.8 up on the ball. You know, I'm used to hitting up on the ball. You hit up on the ball. Spin is 2135, which I don't think that's too low based on how hard you can hit a golf ball.
I'm fine with that number.
Yeah. And, you know, if we were to go up here and normalize it really quick, look at the difference. I mean, we're hitting way into the wind. So it's cool to see that effect of the wind, too. Now, if I go down here, I actually would like to look at, where is the, so there, I'm sorry, I passed it. Spin loft number of 7.7. Now, viewers might not realize what that is. So that's the difference between angle of attack and dynamic loft.
Yes.
All right. So if you can you hit a shot and change that spin loft or at least get that spin way up? And, yep. And we're going to look at the data and see how it changes that. And then we'll talk yep. more about it. And it sounds like you have an example from a student where you had to really work on spin loft and it changed everything.
Yeah, he was very low with his spin loft, too low.
Yeah.
So what I do to control my spin loft, in other words, gain some spin on the ball, is I tee the ball up lower. I feel like I'm hitting down on the ball, which is actually in turn about 3-4 degrees still up on the golf ball. But to me, I feel like I'm hitting down on it.
Okay.
And I feel like I'm kind of moving a little bit more left through impact. So I tend to have a bit of a lower ball flight, obviously, because of that angle of attack.
Yeah.
And it's a little bit more of a cut. So if I'm really, truly trying to find a fairway, ball goes down, I create some speed. If I'm trying to kill a ball, ball goes up, I swing up on it, and it'll go really, it goes really far, but sometimes it goes really far in someone's backyard. So that's what we have to avoid. So all I do is I tee it up lower. It's going to promote me hitting a little bit lower on the club face. The ball launch is going to be a little bit lower. I feel like I'm hitting down on it, even though we're going to see that I'm not, but we should see that spin loft move upwards on us.
Giving us all that data, we'll be able to look at impact and everything. So this will be really cool.
In a lot
angle
of spin.
Angle of attack 2.2.
Yep.
And spin rate was 35.37. Wow. So you lost a little bit of speed, don't get me wrong. 163 versus, you know, 160 or 159. But when you're talking about the actual carry distance, that's the thing that's just sticking out to me right away. I mean, you're talking significant yardage.
Yeah, and I will say I did that spin rate's way higher than I'd want to see. That was
low
heel shot, but
we wanted to show that.
But
know?
That ball's not in someone's backyard either.
Right.
Like, I'm gonna find that golf ball,
and I'll actually pull up the club data really quick. and show you guys that that ball was actually 14 millimeters down on the face. And if we go to the other one, I mean, it was only eight below that, you know, center mark that they're getting. So yeah. It's cool to have all that. So talk a little bit about that example that you were giving me about that student who had, they had a huge gap in spin loft. Mm-hmm. You can explain that a little bit and what they were battling, what you changed.
Yeah. So I had a student, so this is kind of when it comes to club fitting and controlling spin numbers, is I'm actually a bit amazed at the average PGA Tour angle of attack with a driver being as low as it is, actually being down. That kind of blows my mind right there. But I know why they do it. They're trying to gain some, generate a little bit of spin out of their driver, and for them to be more controlled, they feel like they have to hit down. But you have to realize these are the best of the best, okay? The best in the world. They are much more mobile to make changes than the average golfer. So I worked with somebody who, it was freakishly low how low his spin was. He's a tennis player, plays from a shut club face, right? And he hits about 8 degrees up on the golf ball. Okay, so he's basically just standing this club straight up. He's actually, if we really get into deep details, he's toed down with his driver, which tells me that he's standing that handle up, dead shut face. So he's
hitting. You were talking about me at first. Well, that was me. I was stuck this winter, and that was the sub 1,000 backspin.
Yeah, yeah. That, well, that is definitely where it comes from. But standing the handle up, club face shuts, but you're hitting still 8 degrees up on it. So in other words, he had about a 8 degree angle of attack up, and he had about a 12 degree on the high end dynamic face loft. So in other words, his spin loft was about 4. So I had never seen it personally. It's someone who could not get their driver over 1,000 RPMs. It was crazy. So obviously, first thing we're gonna do is we're gonna kind of work on the golf swing. I'm trying to get him to work a little more down and left, get the club moving more around him, get the face a little bit more open. His tennis background with the shut face was, we really fought that. So after a while and some failures, is we decided, you know what? We're done trying to change your golf swing, right? You play from a shut club face.
I'm not, restrictions.
Yeah, we're not fighting this anymore. So what I did with him is I allowed him to make his normal golf swing. I put him in the spinniest shaft that I could. I gave him a 12 degree driver, bumped it up 2 degrees to 14 degrees. So now he's hitting a 14 degree driver. He's about 7 to 8 up now. He's starting to slightly shift it down, but let's still say 8. Still 8 up on it. He has a 14 degree driver that he's now dynamically delivering it close to 18 degrees, and his spin is now in the low to mid 2000s. He came to me, I did this with him last year. It's a student I've worked with a lot. And then we actually did a fitting with him instead of a golf lesson with him to try to manage that spin.
That's what I was talking about. It's not just the swing, it can be the, you know, the degree of the club head, the shaft.
Exactly.
There's so much to it, right?
Yeah. So he came to me at the end of last year, after he had it in his bag for a couple weeks, and he said, I've never hit a driver better in my life. It's unbelievable. Everything is going high now. I can see the ball spinning. It's not just a wounded duck falling out of the sky. It's amazing. And if you look at our actual swing numbers and you look at his swing on video, nothing really changed. We just moved the equipment in his hand, and it worked for him because we were able to control that spin loft number based on the equipment.
And I guess that's, I'll bring up a point really quick. I'm gonna have you hit one more shot if you want to grab your driver and just kind of get ready. I just want you to hit one of your, you're on the tee, you need the distance, you're not trying to come out of your shoes or anything, but I want to tell everybody, you know, back to the PGA Tour data, you know, this is a cool guide. You know, if you're on a launch monitor, you got a lesson, if an instructor's using a launch monitor, he's going to send you, you know, that data, which, you know, most instructors are using, you know, Trackman. All you have to do is just share the data, export it out, you know, and look at that. And if you see gaps, talk about it, you know, bring it up to your instructor before the next lesson. I mean, these are things that you should be on your radar.
Yeah.
And, you know, when you go get 1 hour lesson, there's not enough time to discuss all of that. So take the time. You know, you don't have to fall in a wormhole of data, but look for the outliers, right?
I look for major trends. Like if somebody hits one bad golf shot, I just stand there in silence.
And guess
bad
what?
Golf shot.
Swipe delete right on.
Yeah.
The, right
but
on
if the I
pad,
if I then
iPad, right?
See if I get a collection of about 15 golf shots, then I start looking at trends. I don't look at one bad golf shot and make a change. I make changes based on trends, not on one bad golf shot.
Yeah.
What shot do you want me to hit?
Yeah, go ahead.
My normal swing.
Put the tracer on. They can kind of watch the trace. We'll show like normalization and everything. So. Speed. Tack angle's right back where you want
back
it.
Up.
Spin is 2473. Spin loft. Getting. Would you say that spin loft? I mean, if you're getting close to 10 or so, I mean that's a good number to be around. I mean, I'm sure it's different for everybody. But look at that. I mean, you're 270s. You know, that's carry too, not rollout. Right down the fairway.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I just love everything about that. You got your face the path, face angle. I'll go through this data really quick for everybody. The nice part, if you're being taught on a TM4 or you're fortunate enough to use one, you know someone with one, you can come out here. No marked balls, no markings on any club. You're gonna get full ball data and full club data. So it's all right there. So that launch angle, probably a little bit low for you though, huh?
Yeah, I hit a little low on the heel.
All right, so let's look at that. Well,
yeah,
low on the heel it is. So.
And that's how I get dangerous right there is I was at 2,400 RPMs of spin on a low heel. So imagine if I was high toe.
Just falling out of the sky.
Yep, that thing's.
I mean, this is so insightful. I hope you guys can gather enough out of this to where, you know, you can apply it to your golf game. You know, I'm not saying to go too far advanced with it. Look at those outliers that may apply to you and get yourself a lesson. You know, if you're in the Michigan area, check out hussegolf.com. I mean, Darren, I really appreciate you taking the time and hitting shots on the
absolutely.
Spot and talking about everything and everybody. Just, it's so insightful. You know, I'll tell you what we'll do. We'll dive into some of this and think of the next video to share with the users.
Perfect.
All right, thanks a lot.
Sounds good. You're welcome.